You mentioned we should be humble also in the sense, with the analogy to ants, that they might be better than us. So there's a kind of scale that we're talking about. And in the question, you mentioned the word sentient. So sentience, or maybe the more basic formulation of that is consciousness. Mm-hmm. Do you think that this thing within us humans, in terms of the typical life form of consciousness, is the essential element that permeates other, if there's other alien civilizations out there, that they have something like consciousness as well? Or is this, I guess I'm asking, can you try to untangle the word sentient?
Yeah, so that's a good question. I think what is most abundant depending on how long it survives. So if you look at us as an example, we do have conscious and we do have technology, but the technologies that we are developing are also means for our own destruction, yes, as we can tell. Yes. You know, we can change the climate if we are not careful enough. We can go into nuclear wars. So we are developing means for our own destruction through self-inflicted wounds. And it might well be that creatures like us are not long-lived, mm-hmm, that crocodiles on other planets live for billions of years. They don't destroy themselves. They live naturally. And so if you look around, the most common thing would be dumb animals that live for long times, you know, not those that have conscience. But in terms of changing the environment, I think humans develop tools, they develop the ability to construct technologies that would lift us from this planet that we were born in. And that's something animals without a consciousness cannot really do. And so in terms of looking for things that are new, that went beyond the circumstances they were born into, I would think that even if they're short-lived, these are the creatures that made the biggest difference to their environment, and we can search for them. You know, even if they're short-lived, and most of the civilizations are dead by now.
Yeah.
Even if that's the case.
That's sad to think about, by the way.
Well, but if you look on Earth, that, you know, there are lots of cultures that existed throughout time and they're dead by now. The Mayan culture was very sophisticated, died, but we can find evidence for it and learn about it just by archaeology, digging, yes, into the ground, looking. And so we can do the same thing in space.
Yes.
Look for dead civilizations, and perhaps we can learn a lesson why they died and behave better so that we will not share the same fate. So I think, you know, there is a lesson to be learned from the sky. And by the way, I should also say, if we find a technology that we have not dreamed of, that we can import to Earth, that may be a better strategy for making a fortune than going to Silicon Valley or going to Wall Street.
Yeah.
Because you learn, you make a jump start, yeah, into something of the future.
So that's one way to do the leap, is actually to find, to literally discover versus come up with the idea in our own limited human capacity, like a cognitive capacity.
It would look like, it would feel like cheating in an exam where you look over the shoulder of a student next to you.
Yeah.
But
it's not good on an exam, but it is good when you're coming up with technology that could change the fabric of human civilization. Right. But there is, in my neck of the woods of artificial intelligence, there's a lot of trajectories one can imagine of creating very powerful beings. The technology that's essentially, you know, you can call super intelligence, that could achieve space exploration, all those kinds of things without consciousness.
Right.
Without something that to us humans looks like consciousness. And there, you know, there is a sad feeling I have that consciousness too, in terms of us being humble, is a thing we humans take too seriously. That it's, we think it's special just because we have it, but it could be a thing that's actually holding us back in some kind of way.
May well be. So may well be.